Hi friends, welcome back to Best Way to Study. In this video, we are going to see the complete tutorial of UML. Okay, so UML, what are the uses of UML and what are the types of UML? All these things we are going to see in this particular tutorial. So make sure you watch this video till the end, and also don't forget to subscribe to my channel and hit the bell icon so that you'll never miss a video from Best Way to Study. Okay, so now let's begin this video without any delay. First of all, let's see what is the full form of UML. UML stands for Unified Modeling Language. Okay, so name itself saying that it is a modeling language. That is, we use the pictographical representation, we use diagrams and pictures in order to represent the language. Okay, because instead of text, if the text is converted into diagrams, we can understand the context of the text very easily. Okay, so now let's see. And UML language, like Unified Modeling Language, is the language which is very standard and used by all the companies, okay, all the organizations. Let's see what are the different types of diagrams in UML. Okay, so first most important diagram is use case. Okay, so what is use case? For example, let's think client came to organization, asked the organization in order to develop a website, okay, user friendly website. What is the next step? Organization will ask the client what is the requirement, like what are the different kinds of requirements, and the client will explain. For example, let's think there is a online ticket booking website. Like for example, let's think client wants the organization to develop a online ticket booking website. Okay, so now organization people need to ask client in detail what all are the requirements, then client will be telling all the requirements. Okay, so first step of the organization is they need to gather all the requirements. Okay, client will be explaining one by one. Okay, so first of all, once the user enters the main page, home page of the website, they need to sign up, and then after signing up, they need to book the ticket. They should be able to see what all are the ticket prices available, and for what, which all places the transport is available. All this kind of stuff they need to see. The user should be able to choose a ticket and book the ticket. After booking the ticket, he need to make the online payment. After online payment, the status needs to be seen, like a status of the online payment needs to be pop up, like transaction successful or payment successful, or if the payment is not successful, then it should be like payment unsuccessful. All this kind of things it need to become. The e-copy of the ticket needs to be sent to the user's email. So all these requirements client will explain to the organization. Okay, people who are working in organizations will have knowledge on technical terms, technical language and all, but coming to the client, he is a normal person, he can't understand all the technical terms. So it will be better if we use a pictographical format and explain the client what all they understood, what all the people of the organization understood from client's explanation. Okay, for that reason we mainly use cases. Okay, use cases are nothing but it is a pictographical format, it is a diagram which uses text as well as diagrams. Okay, why we use case is an effective technique. Like using diagram or use case, we can easily understand what all are the requirements of the website or what are the requirements of the system, and also we can easily explain the same to the client or the project. Okay, so now let's see why we use case and what are the advantages of use case. Okay, so first important advantage, as I already told, it is used to gather the requirements of a system. In order to draw a use case, in order to make a use case, first of all we need to gather all the requirements of the system. Okay, so next is outside view of the system. For example, use case is used to get the outside view of the system. What does this mean? See, using the use case, the user can clearly understand how can he sign up, how can he log in, how can he book the ticket, how can he use the website, all these steps. Okay, it will be very helpful in order to understand in a better way for the end user. Okay, there will be a good outside view of a system. Okay, so next is can also understand what are the internal and external features. Okay, so once we understand the requirements thoroughly, only we'll be able to use the use case. We will be able to draw the use case. If we are stuck in between and if we are unable to draw the use case, it means that we didn't understand the requirements thoroughly, so that we can happily go back to the client and ask him to give more requirements. Okay, and next is there will be interaction. Okay, using use case, we can understand who all will have interaction. For example, user will be having interaction with website, admin will have interaction with the website. So like this, we can understand who all will have interaction with the website. Okay, so this is an example of use case. Okay, now let's see what is this example. Okay, once we develop the website, it's not end. Okay, we need to keep on updating the website very frequently, very often. Okay, for maintaining the website up to date, we need a person called admin. Okay, admin is a human being, that's why we are using human being diagram. Okay, so there will be only one admin, that's why we are using one. Okay, so and what will admin do? He will update the website. Okay, that's why I have drawn a vowel shape, circular vowel shape, and I have represented is online update. Okay, admin will be updating the website online. That's why here I have written as admin update. Okay, so there is a relationship, direct relationship between website and admin. That's why I have drew a line, direct line. Okay, so and in order to understand better, I have written here admin update. There will be one admin who will directly update the website, who will make direct online updates to the websites. Okay, so why I have written n means number of, there will be n number of, we'll say, right? So coming to updates, there will not be a single update, right? There will be multiple number of updates. That's why here I have written n. Okay, admin will be making n number of updates in the official website. Okay, so the next is, what is the other thing which admins do? Admins will also be able to see the score. Let's think this is the website of a which will show the online cricket scores updates. Okay, so admin will also be able to view the scores. Okay, admin can also access and view the scores, what all updates he made. Okay, he can n number of scores, like scores will be changing every now and then, right? That's why I have mentioned it as n. Okay, so this is one, and here again we have connected with a line because there is a direct relationship between admin and viewing scores. Admin can directly view the scores and there will be n number of scores, like so. This is the relationship of admin with the website and admin with the view scores. Now let's see, apart from the admin, who all can use the website? Obviously users. Okay, any website will be made only for users, right? So there will be n number of users. Okay, there will be multiple number of users. Coming to this particular site, users can also update the scores. Okay, not only admin, users also will have a limited access in order to update the scores. Okay, these users update the scores, again admin will recheck it, reconfirm it whether they are correct or not. So there will be n number of users and there will be n number of updates. That's why there's a direct line, because there's a direct correlation between users and updates. Okay, so next is there will be n number of users who can view n number of scores. That's why n. Again, on this line, I have written users viewing scores. Okay, so this is all about use case diagram. Now let's see what are the other things about the use case. Okay, so why do we use cases? In order to maintain some diagram in a organized manner. Okay, and actors, as I already told, actors are the human beings who will directly interact with the system. Okay, use case, there will be three different types of things which can be used. There will be three different items. One is functionalities, actors, relationships. Functionalities, actors, relationships. As I have already told you, this is functionality, these are actors, and this is relationship. Only by using these three, we have completed our use case diagram. Okay. So next important diagram is class diagram. Okay, so what is class diagram? Class diagram is a static diagram. What is meaning of static is it cannot be changed. Okay, dynamic means it can be easily changed. The changes can be made very easily. Coming to static, it is fixed. Okay, static means it is fixed. So class diagram is a static diagram and it represents the static view. Okay, so what is the use of class diagram? In class diagram, we can describe what are all the responsibilities that an actor have, does an functionality have, all this. Okay, and class diagram also shows, class diagram is nothing but it is a collection of classes, interfaces, associations, collaboration, and constraint. Okay, classes is nothing but all this we are going to see now once I start explaining the diagram. Okay, class diagram is the base for component and deployment diagram. Okay, so these are the future diagrams which I'm going to explain you, and using class diagram we can also do forward and reverse engineering. Okay, so it is one of the most popular UML diagrams. Almost all the organizations will use class diagrams. Class diagrams helps us to understand top level view. Okay, use case can make us understand outside view, right? But coming to class diagram, it will help us to understand the top level view. Okay, so now let's see what is the class diagram. First, we are taking an actor who is admin, and this is the chain which I am going to explain for admin update. Okay, so how can admin update the website is this class diagram all about. Okay, so first, who is the main person in order to update the website? He is admin. Okay, and admin can have direct relationship with this. Okay, this is a class diagram, and in the class diagram there are three different parts. We can clearly see it, right? So in the first part we'll write name. Okay, for example, admin update. Okay, that is a name. And second part we are going to write the attributes. Okay, this is for attributes, first name, middle name, last name, all these are attributes. Okay, third part we are going to write operations, like what are all the operations which can be performed. Okay, so in the first part, as I told, we wrote admin update, this is the name, and second is attributes. Attributes are nothing but name, first name, and all. Okay, so in order to make some updates, admin need to first of all he need to sign up, right? For the first time he need to sign up. In order to signing up, he need to first give his first name, middle name, last name, all this. Okay, so once he is done, then he'll go to the operation step. Okay, core he needs to register and then login, and then the third step is updation. Okay, this is called control. Okay, this diagram is there, right? This is called control. Okay, so coming to control, whatever changes he made in the front end, let's think this is front end, middle end, and back end. Okay, so whatever changes admin made in the front end, it's going to be processing in this stage, okay, and then it will be stored in the final stage. It will accept data, it will store the data, what all changes are made, it's going to save the data, and if admin wants to retrieve the data from the backend only, the data will be coming, right? So the operations of the backend, it will accept the data, in the sense whatever changes he made, it will accept the back. Whatever changes admin made in the front end, it's the back end is going to be accepting the data, and whatever changes he made and saved, the whatever changes the admin made in the front end, the back end is going to be storing that data. And if any user or admin wants to retrieve some data, he can retrieve from backend. Okay, so next important diagram is sequence diagram. Okay, after class diagram we're going to go through sequence diagram. Sequence is nothing but, see, the name itself is saying sequence. What is sequence? Sequence is nothing but step by step procedure. Okay, sequence diagram will explain us what is the step by step procedure and how the objects interact with each other. Okay, sequence diagram explains us to understand how the objects will communicate with each other, how the objects will interact with each other. See, this is the sequence diagram. Okay, so as you can see, we are using all this directly from the class diagram. Okay, see, in the class diagram we have seen this, right? Control, entity, all this we have seen in class diagram. Okay, so class diagram is the base for sequence diagram. Now let's see, with the help of class diagram, how can we draw the sequence diagram. Okay, first step is we need admin, right? So first admin, what will admin do? Admin will first register himself in order to make any changes. Okay, so first step is scorer registration. Admin needs to register first of all in order to make any changes. Okay, what is the second step? Object is nothing but front end. This is control, which is middle end, and this is back end. Okay, entity is the back end. Okay, this is the second step. Second step is, once the admin registers, he can directly update the score. Okay, this is the second step. And second step is having relationship in between front end and middle end. Okay, that is object and control. So what is third step? The score is updated, it will be processed and saved in the backend, which is entity. Okay, so now in entity, all the updates are saved. This is still third step. Now what is the fourth step? Just with saving the data at the backend does not solve the problem, right? See, once the admin saves the data, he should understand that the data is saved completely, saved successfully, which means he needs to get the pop-up telling successfully saved. Okay, so after accepting the data and saving the data in the back end, and the updated score will be viewed in the front end now. Okay, updated scores will be coming back from back end to middle end, and middle end to front end, the updated scores will be displayed. Okay, and here is the actor. Who is actor? Admin. Admin can see the displayed data. So this is the step-to-step procedure of understanding what are all the updates made, like what are all the steps required in order to save changes or make updates. Okay, important diagram is state chart diagram. What is state chart diagram? State chart diagram is nothing but what are all the different stages that the state undergoes during its entire lifetime. It can be understood using state chart diagram. Okay, it is nothing but it describes the flow of control from one state to another state. Let's see what is the state chart diagram. Okay, so coming to the state chart diagram, this is called beginning. the black big black dot. This is called beginning of the state. Okay, before starting any state or before starting any procedure, we will use this. Okay, this is called starting. Okay, so what is the first state of the object? What is the first step of the object? First is updation. Okay, what all updates we make, that will be stored. That is first step. Second step is data is stored, that will be saved and that will be viewed. Okay, this is second step, second state. And after viewing scores, that is final. Okay, once the user or admin was able to view the final score, there comes the end to the object, there comes the end to the state. Okay, so now we are using black dot and a circle around it. This is called end of the state. This is starting of the state, this is end of the state. Okay, so and using this downward arrow, we need to describe different states of a object in this rectangular box. So it is not completely rectangular, you can see there's a curve to the end of its edge. Okay, so after state chart diagram, there is a activity diagram. Okay, so what is that activity diagram? Using activity diagram, we can understand the activity flow. Okay, what is the different activities which are going through the object? Okay, and there will be different types of activity flows. Okay, there can be parallel flow, there can be branched flow, there can be concurrent flow, different flows. Okay, an activity diagram also helps us to understand if anything is missing in between the object or process. Okay, so another important thing is, before drawing activity diagram, we first clearly need to understand what are the elements required. Okay, so now let's see what are the different elements of activity diagram. First is activities, association, condition, constraints. Okay, so this is the activity diagram. So now let's see what is the activity diagram. First is the login procedure. Let's see what is the procedure. What is the first procedure? We need to enter our username. Okay, so next is we need to enter our password. Okay, so activity diagram is starting from the left hand side, remember. Okay, entering the username, after that next step is entering the password, after that we need to click on the, so what is this procedure? This procedure is logging credentials. Okay, whatever username and password is we have given, it is for login credential. Okay, so after giving login credential, see, you can see the arrows. Okay, after giving login credential, it will check in the back end that it will verify in the back end that whether it is correct or not, whether the username and password is matching or not. Okay, so after that, if the verification is successful, if the login credentials matches, then it will say it is a valid user, else it will say the invalid user. Okay, so after that, if it is valid user, it will display the login menu. If you are invalid user, you cannot log in successfully. Okay, you log in invalidity message. If you are invalid user, then you can see that credentials are not matching message. Okay, so whatever arrows we used, dotted arrows means it is all happening in the back end. Okay, so once you are valid user, you can directly see the login menu. Once you can see the data which you needed. And if you are invalid user, it will again say to re-enter your verification or re-enter your username or password. Okay, and once you re-enter the username and password, again it will go for re-verification. It will verify whether you are valid or invalid user, and then the stage and then the steps will repeat. If you are a valid user, it will display the login menu, else it's going to ask you to re-enter the username and password. Okay, so this is all about activity diagram. Okay, so next let's see what is component diagram. Okay, so what is component diagram? Component diagram, as the name itself suggests, component diagram will describe the components which are used in order to make functionalities. Okay, in order to have a smooth process, what are all the components we need to use will be explained by component diagram. Okay, and coming to the component diagram, you can visualize the physical components. Physical components means packages, libraries, files, all can be used in the component diagram. Okay, and it will also make us understand what are the relationship between the components. See, this is component diagram. Okay, so first is registration form. Once you fill the registration form, you can log in. After logging in, you can verify, like it will be verification process which will go behind the background, like which will go through the background. After, once the verification is successful, once your login credentials are matching, it displays the data. Okay, so these four are different components. As we are using set of components, it is known as component diagram. Okay, so next is deployment diagram. What is deployment diagram? Deployment is nothing but when something is ready to be delivered, something is ready to be deployed, it is called deployment diagram. It will help us to visualize the hardware topology. Topology nothing but networking. Okay, so next is, it will help us to describe what are the hardware components which we are using in order to deploy software components. Okay, and it will also help us to describe runtime processing nodes which we are using in the system. Okay, so now let's see what is the deployment diagram. Okay, so deployment diagram is nothing but this one. Okay, so these are peripheral devices of a system. This is hardware. Okay, keyboard and mouse are the hardwares which we are using in order to make this process happen. Okay, so database is a backend which we all know, which will be used to which will be used to store the data. And this is the processor. Under processor, there will be loginer and database. Like these are the components which will be under processor. Okay, so here, as I told, deployment diagram helps us to understand describe what are the hardwares which we are using, and it will help us to understand what are the software components which we are making. Okay, so under software components, we are using database, loginer and backend other procedures. Okay, and as a hardware components, we are using keyboard and mouse. So yeah, that's it for today. These are the most important diagrams coming to UML. Hope you found this video useful. Thank you so much for watching this video till the end. Don't forget to subscribe to my channel, and also don't forget to hit the bell icon so that you'll be notified whenever I make a new video. Thank you so much for watching till the end, and like and share this video with all your friends.